First, Newsline Prime with Faraz Shaukat Ali.
And a very good evening to you. This is Newsline Prime, live as always from the News First studios in Dawson Street in Colombo. And a very good evening to you, of course, and to discuss the wider picture of the constitutional and political crisis that has engulfed Sri Lanka. I have here with me a very eminent guest, Professor Siri Hetige, Professor Emeritus in Sociology at the University of Colombo and previously Chairman, I think, of the National Police Commission. Am I right, Professor Siri Hetige?
Yeah, that was true.
Thank you very much for being on Newsline Prime. Now then, I wanted to ask you this question. Citizen Hetige, what do you make of all this palaver that's gone on in Parliament? One person, two men are claiming to be Prime Minister. And we have chili powder being thrown, chairs broken, absolute mayhem. What do you make of all that? When you get home and you turn your television on and you see all this, what does it make you feel?
Well, the point is that this is happening, in front of the wider public, and you know, people on a day-to-day basis watch on television all these things unfolding, and the picture that emerges out of this is that there is absolutely no order. There is no established ways of doing things. I'm just wondering how would children watching this kind of drama would make out of it, because the adults, we hear all kinds of news from a whole range of sources, we read newspapers and so on and so forth. So it doesn't really come to us as a surprise, but I'm just wondering how would unsuspecting children would see all these happenings in the Parliament.
Happy that your children are grown up and so on?
Yeah, well, I'm not talking about grown-up children. I'm talking about the children who are sitting
But are you happy that they are not being...
Absolutely.
So what about grandchildren?
I think they just cannot believe that, you can have these kind of things happening. Because, the children are exposed to more orderly environments, in their own lives. Like, for instance, when they go to even a preschool, you can see things happening in a certain orderly fashion. And of course, when they go to a school, they see order and they see the role of the way the school principal is going around and making things, happen. And then the school teachers, when they walk into the school classroom, and children certainly have to respond in a certain fashion and so on. So people start learning, these things from very early age.
Yeah.
Now, of course...
So it's a bad example what's happening.
Well, I think the main point is that this is probably, the most unfortunate thing that has happened in this country. And I don't think that that anyone could, really accept the way things are happening at the moment. And I think the most important reason is that we expect, things to happen in a very serious manner, because you are dealing with, public issues. I mean, the way the country's problems are managed depends very much on what happens in Parliament. They talk about, legislation, they talk about introducing new policies, and then also, making sure that public funds are allocated on a rational basis and so on and so forth. But when you really see what is going on at the moment, people tend to wonder whether all this can be done in an orderly and a reasonable manner. So that's probably what, I would say at this stage, yeah.
How do you, we had those people damaging public property. And we need to set an example. When Presidential Secretary Lalit Wiratunga received a custodial sentence, but his late appeal, but anyway, when he received the custodial sentence, at the time, a lot of people had a lot of sympathy for Mr. Wiratunga because he was a jolly good gentleman. But equally, they said that the law is the law, and he shouldn't have done what he did, even though he was ordered by the president and so on. So there's those standards there. So if that is the case, if those standards are in place, why is it that we have not seen or heard of any form of charges against those people who damaged the public's property inside the Well of Parliament? Why do you think that is?
Well, I do not really know what will happen in the next days and weeks, so we can only hope for the best. Certainly, we are not talking about just discipline here. We are talking about, breaking the law, because we are not supposed to actually damage public property. I mean, you can be charged for vandalism, for instance. I'm not really, interested in going into all these details, but I think there are far bigger problems that we need to discuss, because this is really not what should happen at the highest level of government. Because you see,
how does one put a stop to it? Because they're not learning a lesson. In 2001, MPs turned up inside Parliament and set fire to draft constitutions inside Parliament. And so when I'm looking at that, and I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking we haven't progressed for the last 14, 15
absolutely,
years.
Absolutely. I think, this is really not something that has, happened overnight. There had been a slow, development, or I would say a deterioration, if you like, of standards, not just among politicians, but also among other segments of society. So I think we certainly cannot continue, and we need to really revisit this whole situation and figure out how we could really restore some degree of order, some degree of discipline, and also, of course, rule of law. I mean, that is probably the last resort that the citizens have to get what they really desire, that is, public order to be maintained, because, our day-to-day lives depend so much on public order. I mean, we should be able to move around without really looking over the shoulders of the other people, at the other people, because, I think public order gives us the confidence that we could engage in our day-to-day activities without worrying about, whether you're going to...
I want to ask you this question because you might be the best person to answer this. Now, you're a professor. Do you actually lecture at the university?
I do, yeah.
Right, so how do you detect? What do you detect for those young people that are coming up? Are they a good bunch? Do you see some different standards and expectations?
Well, the point is that they are the most talented people, because they go through this very competitive process, from primary school upwards. I mean, as you know, I'm not really in favor of examination oriented education. I think we should, go beyond examination oriented education to have a more holistic type of education, so that you develop the full potential of each and every child. So, of course, examination-oriented education doesn't really help in that. But in spite of all that, we see the talented people somehow coming up, and they end up in the university, and certainly they can be considered as very good material. whether we really turn this very good material into, let's say, very talented, you know, competent individuals who could really take up important positions in various institutions or not, I think is something that we need to discuss, because it doesn't happen across the board, and certainly we have so much inequality within our education system, and as a result, not all of these people really are in a position to make best use of the opportunities given to them. Like, for instance, you know, we have you know, libraries full of books, but we have deprived them of the ability to read these books, because, you know, they are not bilingual, and therefore most of them can read only in the language that they are comfortable with, and that is their mother tongue. But as you know, these days we rely on so many sources of information which you can only make use of only if you have a second language. But in Sri Lanka, we have deprived our younger generations of that facility. So I think, I mean, that's just, you know, one area where, you know, we need to really talk about. But the fact of the matter is that we have had successive governments coming into power over the last several decades. But our issues, you know, in various areas like education and so on and so forth, have not been, you know, really addressed in a reasonable manner. And as a result, we have seen accumulation of problems. I mean, I mean, we have been discussing various issues, you know, in transport, in health, education.
But I was going to ask you, education, is it, is enough money being spent?
Well, I think the point is that we spread whatever we spend very thinly, and as a result, we don't really have been able to, we have not been able to really provide equal opportunities. For instance, if you take the general education system, we still see huge disparities between rural and urban. For instance, we are talking about STEM education today. That is, you know, professionally oriented, science-based, you know, curriculum. But the fact of the matter is that majority of our secondary schools do not have facilities to offer the science stream, which means that there is a huge gap. Now, say about, you know, 30% of the schools can offer a science stream at A level, but you know, the other schools, you know, don't have the facility. Similarly, language teaching, I mean, it's a total failure. Today, I would say a vast majority of our teachers cannot really teach, you know, anything in a language other than their own. Like, for instance,
you mean Sinhalese?
Yeah, I mean, well, I mean, you can
or
teach
or Tamil.
That's the point. So you know, I mean, I think that, you know, in a country like Sri Lanka, a teacher, you know, is going to be far more effective if he or she is bilingual, because then you are not confined to your own language.
So where is the problem then? How do you fix the problem?
Well, that is exactly where the policies come in, and we have seen how the policies have evolved in this area over the last 70 years. And, you know, it has not evolved in a way to address the real problem. Now, for instance, we had, you know, before independence, this whole problem of English versus the rest. And then, of course, we had, you know, Kanangara, you know, free education reforms in the, you know, in the early 1940s. Where they found a formula, you know, effective formula, you know, whereby they, you know, basically ensured that those who went beyond secondary education, you know, came out as bilingual, you know, people. But then again, we changed that policy in the 50s, and today we have a situation where vast majority of our, you know, so-called educated youth are not bilingual. So the point is that the policies have had a huge impact. on educational outcomes. Now, I think these are probably issues that...
But is there enough money being spent on education?
Well, certainly not. I mean, the point is that we, you know, we have something like 1.6% of the GDP being spent on education. And this has been the pattern for the last, 30, years or more.
Now that the wars stop, why can't they use more money?
Well, I don't think that we have taken a decision to rationally allocate public funds across various sectors. We haven't taken that decision. I mean, if you look at the budget, if you look at the budget, how funds are allocated, even the most recent budget, 2018 budget, you can see the vast majority of the ministries are getting a very, very small, amount of money.
Right.
For instance, if you take social services, and I would say social services would be one of the priority areas for a country like Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
But then again, we don't really allocate a reasonable amount of money for social services.
Yeah.
And education, of course, underfunded.
Yeah.
Education system has expanded. I mean, we have now, 15 or 16 universities, right?
Yeah.
Whereas we had only a handful of universities, let's say 20 years ago. Now the question is whether we have increased the amount of money for education because we increased the number of universities. We haven't done that.
Yeah.
We basically maintained the same level of public spending on education.
But now in other countries, everywhere you go, there's a blessed, there are universities everywhere, and there are graduates and so on. But in Sri Lanka, we have so little. And so many people wanting to go to university that, like you said earlier in the program, that only the right at the top get in.
Mm.
So how does the government address this if they're only spending 1.something%?
No, but I think the point is it's not a question of expanding education. It is a matter of, improving quality of education. Even if you don't expand, the education system, tertiary education system, to accommodate more students, you still need a lot more money to provide, various facilities for university students. Now, for instance, research,
So what did you say? Are you saying that if there is the amount of university spaces is sufficient?
No, I'm not saying that. But the point is that the question is, what do these people do when they leave the university? Today, graduate unemployment problem is a big one. We have had this graduate unemployment problem for the last 30 years or more.
So that must be a failure on the part of the planners.
Well, obviously, it's not only a matter of education, it's also a matter of the economy. So the point is that the people who leave the university system should be absorbed by various sectors of the economy. For instance, where is the industrial sector in this country? Industrial sector has not diversified, has not expanded. Agricultural sector has not expanded, not diversified. And we have a massive service sector. Now, you look at the economic data. I mean, you look at, the trade gap. Trade gap has been widening. What is this trade gap that we are talking about? The amount of money that we earn by exporting whatever we export is not enough to pay for what we import. In fact, as I have said this several times, it is only about 52% or 53% of the trade gap, 52% of the money that we earn exports is adequate to pay for imports. In other words, there is a huge gap between imports and exports, import earnings and export earnings. And then, how do we really bridge the trade gap? We bridge the trade gap basically using the money sent by workers employed in other countries. It's about 70% of the trade gap is covered by remittances. And the rest, of course, comes from, you know, other sources, like, you know, for instance, tourism. Mm. And of course, the balance we probably manage.
I want to try and bring this conversation back into the current. Now, we were talking about education and so on.
Mm.
I read somewhere that 94 members of Sri Lanka's parliament don't have a basic like the O-level. They don't have that. This is out of 225.
Mm.
Isn't that worrying, that kind of thing?
Well, absolutely. I think the main problem in this country is that we don't take merit into consideration.
Mm.
You know, we have to ask the question, now when you appoint someone for a position in an institution, if it's a private institution, you would naturally want to get the best person, because you know, the performance of that person is so critical for your organization. Now I think the same should apply everywhere. For instance, when you appoint somebody as the, let's say, the Minister of Education or Minister of Agriculture, whatever, I mean, you should, you know, find out whether the person has the necessary credentials to be considered that very important position. So, I mean, the point is that we now say, for instance, what is happening in Parliament? Basically, what is happening in Parliament, you know, can be considered in two ways. Certainly, we want the legislations to be, you know, presented, debated and passed by Parliament. I mean, legislation, you know, everything, you know, depends on, you know, legislation, because, you know,
but some of our parliamentarians are better off as street fighters, and then we expect them to come and And that's what we saw the other day.
No, I mean, not only that. Now we are talking about legislation. I mean, that's a very serious matter. And then we also talk about policies. You know, for every sector.
So all these serious things, how do they debate?
Absolutely. Now see, I'll give an example. Now, you know, we have had commissions being appointed to inquire into various issues. You know, like, for instance, you know, local government reform commission report, you know, migration, you know, labor migration, there was a task force and there was a big report. And then on the plantation sector, there was a big report.
So we seem to be very good at doing reports.
No, I'm getting at a different point, actually.
Yeah.
Now, you see, all these are very, very detailed, extensive reports that provide you with all the necessary information required for to analyze the problems in that particular sector, and then to come up with policies to address those issues, and to develop strategies, and then develop plans and implement those. Now the question is whether the people who are really, you know, going into these institutions have the capacity, have the, you know, the credentials that are necessary for them to be able to perform those very, very, you know, important functions. Now, I think that's why I said that, you know, in this country, we do not take merit into consideration, particularly when it comes to public institutions. Public institution. I know that, you know, if you establish a private company, you have no choice. You have to get the best people to manage your company. Otherwise, your company is going to collapse in no time, because you have to really compete in a very competitive market, and therefore you have to be really on top. So I think the same principle should be applied across the board, and I think it should be equally applicable to all the institutions, all the public institutions. But unfortunately, you know, we have not been able to do that, you know, in a systematic manner, and as a result, we have this huge problem. I mean, I think, you know, as I already mentioned, education is one of those. But then, you know, you look at all the other areas, like, for instance, the agricultural sector. Now, to really revamp our agricultural sector, we have to really do a great deal of work. I mean, you know, we need to really look at how we could improve productivity, how to really introduce new let's say, agricultural techniques, you know, how to introduce, you know, various technologies and so on and so forth, how to control, you know, various challenges that the, you know, producers face and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, what do you, how do you process your product, for instance, you know, how to really take the excess, you know, production away and process them, you know, through agro-based industries and so on and so forth. Now, all these things demand people in charge to be really on top in terms of what happens in the rest of the world. What happens in the rest of the world? Because, you know, we are not alone in this world. I mean, agriculture is not something that happens only in Sri Lanka. You go to other countries, you can see how people manage agriculture. Yeah. I mean, you go to East Asia and you can see how they are managing their agricultural, you know, activities. You know, from let's say the farm level, right up to, you know, let's say the market, where, you know, agro-based industries have, you know, basically come out with all kinds of products and are being marketed and so on and so forth. So I think, you know, in each and every sector, it is absolutely necessary to have the best, you know, persons to really, you know, contribute. In terms of coming out with the policies, in terms of, you know, developing strategies and so on and so forth. I think if we continue, you know, in the way that we have been doing things over the years, I don't think that we are going to make any difference, even if there is a change of government tomorrow.
So is it a long battle?
Well, absolutely. I think we have to ask some fundamental questions in this country. You know, why do we change governments? Why do we bring, you know, new people into?
And what about this, Professor? What do you, because of, obviously education question. This should we encourage more? Should we encourage the private sector to have universities and so on?
Well, the point is that we already have. I don't think that it is something new, because you see we have...
Yeah, but do we have enough? We say we don't have enough.
No, I think, you know, we cannot really get out of the present, you know, problems that we
have. Why? Why can't we just build more universities?
But the point is, where do these people go at the end of the day? I mean, you can produce more and more, you know, graduates.
But isn't that short-term thinking? Isn't it better to have a very educated population so that when international companies look at our labor pool here, they find a whole dearth of highly qualified people?
No, but they are not going to wait till, you know, investors come and start new ventures.
You're going to start somewhere.
Isn't it better to
export educated, knowledgeable workforce rather than domestic workers?
No, but that is exactly what we have been doing. I mean, all the top quality, you know, products of our education system have moved out. I mean, you go to any country in the world, you know, in the Western world, the developed world, you know, you see all the, you know, Sri Lankan professionals occupying very important positions in various sectors. So I don't think that this is something new. You know, I think the point is that things should happen simultaneously across different sectors. You know, if, you know, you cannot really change the education system and expect, you know, changes to happen in the other sector. It should happen simultaneously. I mean, you know, the people should, you know, concentrate on the economy. I think if you neglect the economy and try to, you know, find other ways to solve our problems, we are not going to really get anywhere. So I think there is a complementarity between education and the economy. And I think that complementarity, you know, has to be recognized. And we need to really concentrate on both simultaneously. You know, we have to concentrate on the economy, the agriculture, industry,
as well
and
as
the services. But the main problem is that, you know, we have neglected the productive sectors of our economy for the last so many decades. And as a result, we have a highly distorted economy today in this country. And that is what really generates all these pressures.
A highly distorted economy Professor Siri Hettige, thank you very much as we come to an end to Newsline Prime. And I would ever that it's a very highly politicized society that we live in as well.
Absolutely.
and that may be to the detriment of this country, which is why News First urges you to think and to think again.
We have given too much prominence to politics in this country.
Too much prominence to politics. But here we go. We shall end with our country first vision. In the meantime, thank you very much, Professor Siri Hettige. We've run out of time. Thank you, take care, have a great evening, and God bless.
These are the political, economical, and social problems in the country. Divide the classroom into two and hold a debate. This group to my right will speak for the topic, and the group to my left will oppose the topic. Now, it is better if you do it the way they do it in the parliament, like the ruling party and the opposition. Use that.
Thank you. We hope to take this country forward for the midterm projects in the country. The people of this country are suffering.
Stop! I did not ask you to debate like how they would in parliament to start a fight. It was to build this country.
Think. Never vote them into parliament again. Our future and our children's future depends on it.
News First, Newsline, Prime with Araz.